Hello guys, in the last lecture we looked at what is electrical conductivity of the material, and we said that the electrical conductivity is given by sigma is equal to J by E, and then we said that the electrical conductivity can also be represented in terms of electrical mobility of charge carriers, where mobility is the measure of how easy it is to move a charge carrier under the influence of electric field. And it is defined as mu is equal to V by E. Now, in terms of electrical mobility, the electrical conductivity is equal to mu E N, where mu is the mobility of charge carriers, E is the charge on the charge carriers, and N is the density, charge carrier concentration of the charge carrier. Then we discuss about semiconductor, and we said that okay, in case of semiconductor, both electrons and hole conduct electricity, and hence the current will be partly because of the current because of holes and current due to electrons, and hence the electrical conductivity of semiconductor will be because of conductivity due to electrons and conductivity because of holes, and the electrical conductivity of semiconductor is equal to mu E E into Ne plus mu H E into Nh. Please note over here is that if I have n-type semiconductor, in n-type semiconductor charge carrier concentration of electron is much larger than charge carrier concentration of holes, and hence I can safely write electrical conductivity for n-type material is equal to mu E N E into E, where mu E is the mobility of electron, Ne is the charge carrier concentration of electron, and E is the charge on the electron. Similarly, in case of p-type material, since number of holes will be much larger than number of electrons, hence in this particular equation this particular number mu H E and H will be much larger than mu E E and E, and I can neglect this particular part, and hence the electrical conductivity is simply mu H E and H, where mu H is the mobility of holes, NH is the charge carrier concentration of holes, and E is the charge on hole. So even though we can write the electrical conductivity in this particular form, in extrinsic semiconductor any one out of these will be dominating, and hence other can be neglected. Then we discuss about Hall effect. So we said that okay, using Hall effect we can measure electrical conductivity, we can measure the mobility of electron, we can measure the charge carrier concentration, we can measure the polarity of charge carriers, and so on and so forth. Then we discuss about what is Hall effect, and we say that okay, if I have a material something like this, and along two parallel faces if I applied electric field, so along this face and this face I have applied electric field, and if I applied magnetic field perpendicular to these two faces, okay, so along this face and back face, front face and back face, I have applied the magnetic field, then a voltage will be developed on top face and the bottom face. So along right face and left face I have applied electric field, along front face and back face I have applied magnetic field, so voltage will be developed across top face and bottom face. And we seen that how the voltage got developed, and this voltage is known as Hall voltage, and this particular effect of developing Hall voltage is known as Hall coefficient. So let's look at mathematical details of this Hall effect. So the experiment setup is something like this. I have a material, so let me show you the diagram. So I have this particular case. So let's suppose along x-axis I have applied electric field, so the current is flowing in this direction. Along z-direction I have applied magnetic field, then voltage will be developed along the y direction, right? So the diagram could look something like this. So this right face and left face, along this right face and left face I have applied electric field, along the front face and the back face, magnetic field is applied. So magnetic field is applied along this direction. Then on top face and bottom face. So on this particular face and this particular face. So along these two faces, I will get voltage developed. Right? Okay. So let's say that the length of this particular material is small l. The height is, let's say, h, and the width of this material is, let me call it as d. So the cross-sectional area of this material A will be equal to the cross-sectional area through which the current is flowing is equal to h into d, and the length through which the current is flowing is l. And the volume of the material obviously will be L into H into D. Now, when I apply the electric field, what's going to happen? When this particular thing is developing, what is going to happen? So, because of the magnetic field, the positive charge will be moving in upward direction. So, there will be an accumulation of positive charge at the top surface, and on the bottom surface, there will be accumulation of negative charge. Now this positive charge will create an electrical potential, and this electrical potential, since this is positive potential, it will be from positive to negative, so it will oppose the flow of electron. So because of this magnetic field, so this is the force produced because of the magnetic field, and because of this Hall voltage, there will be some force applied, but that force will be in downward direction, and this is my Hall force. Now, after some time, what's going to happen is that this force because of the magnetic field and force because of this Hall voltage or Hall potential, they will neglect each other, and the electron will move in a straight line direction, but the charge carriers can move in a straight line direction. This is known as the equilibrium situation. So basically something like this is happening. Electron is coming over here, the positive charge is coming and sitting on the top surface, negative charge is coming and sitting on the bottom surface, and it will create a electric field. So when the next electron next positive charge try to go in upward direction, this particular electric field will oppose this particular motion, and at one particular point this electric field will be sufficient to oppose the upward force because of the magnetic field. And when that happens, we say that the system is in equilibrium. So at equilibrium, the force because of magnetic field balances the force, balanced by the force created by the Hall voltage. Right? Now what is the magnetic force because of the magnetic field? The force because of the magnetic field will be Q V cross B. And what will be the force because of Hall voltage? The force is electrical in nature. So this positive and negative charge, they will create some electric field. Let's call it as Hall electric field. So that would be EH into charge of the charge carrier will be the force. So the electric field FE is equal to E into E. Right? Where E is the charge. The same thing I have written. Please note one particular thing over here is that I applied external voltage V and I am getting a voltage VH, right? So this external, because of this external voltage, there will be an electric field, and I am not considering that particular electric field. That electric field is accelerating this particular charge carriers in this direction. Okay, so that's there. What is balancing? Only the magnetic field and the Hall voltage, they are getting balanced. So this is the Hall electric field we are talking about. Now when they get balanced, we are going to get something like this. We are going to get EH is equal to V cross B, where V is the velocity. And B is the magnetic field. Now, do I know, can I measure the velocity in this particular experiment? No. However, I can measure what is current and Hall voltage. Even I cannot measure the electric field, I can convert, obviously convert this into I can convert this Hall voltage into electric field, but I cannot directly measure, but I can measure the voltage. Okay, so I want to convert this particular equation using this particular things, current flowing through the material and VH. Now, what is the current flowing through the material? As we have seen in the previous lecture, the current flowing is equal to charge carrier concentration into charge on the charge carriers into velocity of the charge carriers into area, isn't it? See, we have looked at over here while discussing the electrical conductivity. Over here, NEVDA, the same thing I am writing over here, right? So I can write velocity V will be equal to I divided by NE A. And what is A? Area. As you can see, the cross sectional area is height into width of the material, H into D. So this will be equal to I divided by NE H into D. So this equation will become something like this. EH will be equal to IB divided by NE H into D. But what is EH in terms of Hall voltage? So in terms of Hall voltage, EH will be equal to EH will be equal to VH into the amount of length for which this electric field is applied. What is that amount? That amount is H. Along this height, the Hall voltage is applied. So that would be divided by H. So I'm going to get something like this. VH is equal to IB NE NE HH will get cancelled into D. And this particular quantity 1 over NE is known as Hall coefficient RH, and hence we are going to get Hall voltage will be equal to RH IB divided by D. Right? So if I know what is the amount of current flowing through the material, if I know what is the applied magnetic field, and if I know what is the width of the material, I can find out, and if I know, obviously I can find out what is the, I can measure the Hall voltage. So if I know Hall voltage, current, magnetic field and width of the material, I can find out what is the value of RH. And if I know the value of RH, I will know what is the charge carrier concentration N. If RH is known, I can know what is the charge carrier concentration. So if I calculate RH, the first thing that we are going to do, we can know charge carrier concentration can be known. Now if once the charge carrier concentration is known, it's very simple. Now sigma is equal to mu en. And what is this mu E? So either I need to know what is the charge conductivity of a material or the mobility of the material, because En is nothing but 1 over RH. So by knowing this RH value, or either mu or sigma, if I know mu no hai, so I can find what is the electrical conductivity. और अगर मुझे इलेक्ट्रिकल कंडक्टिविटी पता है, आई कैन फाइंड आउट व्हाट इज म्यू. एंड डिपेंडिंग ऑन व्हाट इज द साइन ऑफ दिस आरएच, दैट इज वेदर दिस ई इज प्लस और माइनस, आई विल गेट पोलैरिटी ऑफ चार्ज कैरियर्स. So basically, if I do this experiment something like this, if positive terminal is connected on the top surface and negative terminal is connected on the bottom surface of the voltmeter, and this negative terminal of battery is connected on the left side and positive terminal is connected on the right hand side, then if I get a positive voltage over here, then the charge carriers are holes. And if I get a negative voltage over here, I'm going to get electron as a charge carriers. Okay. So by knowing what the value of RH, I can find out this. And the fourth thing obviously is polarity of charge carriers. So I can find out what is the polarity of charge carriers and so on and so forth using the Hall experiment. So this is about the Hall experiment. Now let's discuss about the diode. So what we are going to discuss is about the first electronic component we are going to discuss is diode. So in diode, you join together a p-type material and a n-type material. So I have a p-type material and I have a n-type material, and when this particular p-type and n-type material fuse together, you get what is known as diode. So can I do something like this? Suppose I have this p-type material with me and I have this n-type piece of material with me. Can I join them together using some glue and form a p-n junction? No, that's not going to work. So basically, in order to form a p-n junction, what you need, you have a piece of silicon and you dope in this direction, you dope with p-type impurity. And on this particular side, you dope with n-type impurity. And you get this p-n junction form. So the construction of diode is very, very simple. You have a p-type material, you have n-type material, and when you join them together, you get a p-n junction. Now in case of p-n junction, this p-terminal is known as anode. So you get a connection from p-type material, you get a connection from n-type material. The p-type material is known as anode and n-type material is known as cathode. Okay. And the symbol for diode is something like this. Please note, I have drawn a straight line because it is only allowing a flow of current in one direction. So this arrow indicates a flow of electron, and this straight line indicate that the flow is only in one particular direction. So we are going to see the working of the diode, and that time it will be apparent to you the why this particular symbol is used for diode. So this is p-n junction diode. So let's see what's going to happen when I join together a p-type material and n-type material. So I have this p-type material with me. So over here I have lots of holes which can conduct electricity. So the majority charge carriers on this particular side, this p-type material is hole, and I have this n-type material with me. And there are large numbers of electrons present. So the majority charge carriers in this n-type material is electron. And when I join them together, so what's going to happen? So let's suppose this is the junction that is created, and over here I have a large number of holes. And I have a large number of electrons over here. So if I look at microscopic scale, what's going to happen is something like this. Over here, I have silicon, or so let's say boron atom over here, and there will be a hole created at this particular point in p-type material. And in n-type material, what I have something like this. I have a phosphorus. And a electron is over here, right? Now as there are large number of electrons in this n-type material, this is n-type, this is p-type. As there are large number of electrons in n-type material, these electrons will start diffusing. So what's going to happen? This electron will cross this particular junction. So as this electron leaves this n-type material, so if I look at this particular n-type material, we discuss it several times. This is a neutral material. And p-type also is a neutral material. Okay. Now, as I'm removing an electron over here, this, let's say this electron is removed from this particular neutral material, what's going to happen? There will be a positive charge created. Right? Okay, so when this electron diffuses into p-type material, since the electron is removed from this particular point, so this phosphorus, I'm removing the electron from this particular phosphorus, and this electron is going in this direction, so this phosphorus will become a positive charge. Right? Similarly, when this electron arrives at this particular point, it can recombine with this particular hole. So basically, yahan pe jo hole created hua tha, this electron can come and sit at this particular position. So initially, this p-type material was neutral and I have added an electron into it. What's going to happen? It will become a negatively charged material. So because of that, I'm going to get a negative charge developed over here. So there will be a negative charge developed over here. So at the junction, what's going to happen? Since the electrons from n-type material is recombining with holes in a p-type material, near the junctions in the p-type material, I'm going to get a negative charge, and in n-type material, I'm going to get a positive charge. So this is p-type, this is n-type. You understand this particular thing? Negative charge because I have added one electron, positive charge because I have removed one electron. Now, when the next electron tries to jump from n-type material into p-type, what's going to happen? This negative and positive charge, they will create an electric field, and the electric field will oppose the motion of this electron. Now, if the velocity of electron is sufficient, then it can again come in this particular direction and it can recombine with a hole, and there will be another negative charge and there will be another positive charge created. This process goes on. And ultimately, what is going to happen? The electric field now is sufficient to oppose the flow of electron from n-type material into p-type material. So now, the electron cannot come from n-type to p-type material. So near the junction, I have got some charges created. And this particular immobile charges that I have created is known as depletion region. So, let me use a different color. So, when an electron make a transition from n-type material into p-type material, I have got developed a negative potential or negative charge at p side and positive charge in n side. And because of that, there will be some potential. And this is very close to the junction. The actual junction is this. Very close to the junction, I have created a negative charge in this direction and positive charge in this direction. So negative charge over here, positive charge over here. Right? And the region in which this distribution takes place is known as depletion region. And now since this electric field will create a potential, now the electron cannot cross this particular junction. And this potential created by this electric field is known as depletion potential. Right? So, in order for this electron to make a transition from n-type material to p-type material, the electron need to overcome this particular potential. So, mujhe kya karna padega? Is electron ko is potential se jyada ka potential dena padega. That time this electron can cross this junction, right? So when this particular depletion region forms, we say that the diode is in equilibrium now. So all the diodes, when they are not applied connected to any battery, they are in this particular form. So ultimately what you end up with, you end up with something like this. You have, this is p-type material on this side, on this side you have n-type material. So this is the junction, and at the junction you have a depletion region, and you have a positive, sorry, in p-type you have a negative potential, and in n-type you have equal positive potential. And there are lots of holes in p-type material still, and there are lots of electrons, free electrons in n-type material. Now what's going to happen if there are free electron or hole in this particular junction? So I can show it something like this. Let me draw a bigger diagram. So this is a junction. So this is shown something like this. Now what is going to happen? Suppose I incident some radiation, and because of that electron from valence band goes into conduction band. So I have created electron and hole pair. What's going to happen now? Since this electron is negatively charged, it will be attracted toward this positive potential, and it will go into n-type material, and this hole will go into p-type material. So in depletion region, no free charge carriers reside. In depletion region, all the free charge carriers are either in p-type material region or n-type material. In depletion region, there are no free charge carriers. Okay, please look over here. The electron, even if generated in the depletion region, it will quickly be absorbed in n-type material, and the hole will be absorbed in p-type material. So this is p-type and this is n-type material. So this is what p-n junction is. Now let's look at the working of this particular p-n junction. So working, for working I can connect this particular diode. So this is the anode and this is the cathode. This is the symbolic diagram, and this is the construction diagram of p-n junction diode. So this is p-type material, this is n-type material, this is anode and this is cathode. I can either connect the cathode to a positive terminal or negative terminal. So let's say, what will happen if I connect it to a positive terminal? So what is going to happen if I connect a p-type material to a positive terminal of battery and n-type material to a negative terminal of battery? Such a condition is known as forward biasing. So when I forward bias the material, what's going to happen? Now the electron, let's look at the microscopic picture that we have created. So this is depletion region, this is positive potential, and this is negative potential, and I have connected positive terminal, negative terminal, and let's say I have an electron. Since I have connected a negative potential, this electron will gain more amount of energy, and it can overcome this positive barrier, and it can cross this particular junction. Now if suppose for some reason this potential is less than the barrier potential, so this depletion potential is known as barrier potential. Okay, so what is going to happen if the applied potential is less than the barrier potential? If the applied potential is less than the barrier potential, then the energy of this electron will not be sufficient to cross this particular junction, and the electron cannot go from this n-type material to p-type material. So there will be no flow of electrons. So if the potential is less than barrier potential, then no flow of electrons. So there will be no current. But what will happen if barrier potential is large than barrier potential. So applied potential is larger than barrier potential. What's going to happen? At that particular time, this electron will have sufficient amount of energy so that it can overcome this particular potential and it can jump into p-type material. So there will be a flow of electron or current. So if I draw a graph, if I try to draw a graph, on y-axis I am recording the current and on y-axis I have voltage, and suppose this barrier potential is somewhere here. This is the barrier potential. So what's going to happen? There will be no current up to this particular point, or very small amount of current will flow up to this particular point, and then the current suddenly rises. Right? And then the current suddenly rises. Because of thermal energy, there will be some small amount of current flowing even below the barrier potential. So up to the barrier potential, there will be no flow of current, and after the barrier potential, the current suddenly increases. This particular characteristic is known as forward characteristic of the atom. Right? So when I connect p-type material to a positive potential, n-type material to a negative potential, then below a barrier potential, if the applied voltage is less than the barrier potential, there will be very small amount of current or no current. And then when the applied potential is larger than or equal to the barrier potential, the amount of current suddenly increases. This is forward characteristic. Now let's look at what's going to happen when I connect it in a reverse bias condition. So basically, what's going to happen if I connect the diode in this particular configuration? P-type material is connected to negative potential and N-type material is connected to a positive potential. So basically, this is my P-N junction. So this is P-type, this is N-type, and I connected P-type to a negative potential and N-type to a positive potential. What's going to happen? So over here, when I replace this by something like this, negative potential and positive potential, now since this electron here is a positive potential, the electron will be attracted in this particular direction. So there will be even the energy of electron will not be very large to cross this junction because it is going away from the junction. Right, so the electron cannot cross this particular junction. However, in and this p-type material as well as in n-type material, there are some minority charge carriers, correct? So in p-type, what are the minority charge carriers? Electrons are minority charge carriers in p-type material, and n-type material, holes are the minority charge carriers. So this positive potential will increase the energy of these holes, and this negative potential will increase the energy of these minority charge carriers electrons in p-type material, and hence this electron can cross this junction and there will be some small amount of current, and this particular current is because of the minority charge carriers. So when I connect the diode in a reverse bias condition, the majority charge carriers cannot conduct electricity. Whatever electricity is conducted, it is because of minority charge carriers only, right? And since the minority charge carriers are very, very small, the amount of current will also be very, very small. So in a reverse bias condition, a very small amount of flows, and this small amount of current is because of minority charge carriers, right? So I'm going to get something like this. In a positive forward bias condition, up to barrier potential, no current, and then the current suddenly increases. So this is known as barrier potential. In reverse bias direction, a very small amount of current flows. So here voltage, here current. So when the voltage is positive, means p-type is connected to positive terminal, then this is known as forward bias. And when the voltage is negative, obviously the current will be because of the opposite charge carriers, and hence it is in negative direction. So this is called as reverse bias condition. Please note that the forward current is in milliamperes and the reverse current is very 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 small, so it is measured in microamperes. Now if I go on increasing this particular reverse bias potential, what's going to happen? These electrons that are crossing from p-type to n-type, they will have a very large velocity, right? Because this potential is large, so they will be accelerated at a larger scale, and they can collide with the neighboring atoms and they can knock out the electron, and this electron again will move with a very large velocity and it can again knock out some electrons, and there will be suddenly a rise in current. This particular condition of knocking the electron from a neighboring ions is known as breakdown. This is, and hence at a very large potential you get a sudden increase in current, and this particular point is known as avalanche breakdown. And if this particular condition appears, then we cannot recover the PN junction diode. Okay, so the characteristic of a material, forward and reverse characteristic, looks something like this. PN junction diode, so a very small amount of current flows and then the current increases abnormally in forward direction. In the reverse direction as well, the current is very 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 small, and after some time it suddenly increases. So over here I have voltage, over here I have current, and this is in microampere, this is in milliampere. This particular point, if I extend it on the x-axis, this is known as barrier potential, and this particular point is known as avalanche breakdown point, VA. This is called as avalanche because if you know about avalanche, in avalanche what happens if I have a snow peaks, mountains, and some particular snow breaks from this particular mountain, so it comes with very large velocity, and when it is coming down, जो बाकी का बर्फ होता है उसको भी अपने साथ लेके आता है, तो उसका वॉल्यूम बहुत ज्यादा बढ़ जाता है. द सेम थिंग इज हैपनिंग ओवर हियर. व्हेन दिस इलेक्ट्रॉन इज मूविंग इन दिस पर्टिकुलर डायरेक्शन, इट इज रिमूविंग इलेक्ट्रॉन फ्रॉम नेबरिंग आयन्स, एंड दोज इलेक्ट्रॉन अगेन रिमूविंग इलेक्ट्रॉन फ्रॉम नेबरिंग आयन्स. सो समथिंग लाइक अ वैलेंसी इज टेकिंग प्लेस ओवर हियर, एंड बिकॉज ऑफ दैट देयर विल बी अ ह्यूज अमाउंट ऑफ करंट, एंड दैट्स व्हाई दिस इज नोन एज अ वैलेंसी ब्रेकडाउन. And if an avalanche breakdown takes place in a diode, the diode cannot be recovered. So this is diode. We will further discuss about this particular characteristic of diode in the next lecture.